Hello, everybody. My name is Ledeczi, and I guess it's my turn to present this work. That's a joint work with lots of people. Not even everybody is listed here. And let me try to maximize my screen. Okay. Can you guys see my screen? Okay. So, the title of the presentation is Exploring Climate Change with Programming Projects. And as I said, it's a fairly large project. It's partially supported by NSF and also Vanderbilt University gave us some seed money to work on this topic. So some of you may not be familiar with NetsBlox. NetsBlox is a snap extension, okay? And the idea that we had probably 5 or 6 years ago is to bring distributed programming capabilities to block-based environments. So why? Just briefly, I mean, most of the applications and programs we work with are distributed. That means it doesn't run on a single computer, but it actually connects to the internet and kind of makes a collaborative project, so to speak, getting data from other computers and so on and so forth. And since that's the case, why not try to teach the basics of distributed computing to students, to novice programmers? Yeah, so what does it enable? Well, we can do all kinds of fun things with NetsBlox. You can create multiplayer games where students are actually playing the game on their own computer against each other, wherever they are on the internet. We can provide access to lots of interesting online data sources. We also enable Google Docs like collaboration. Students can work on the same project from their own computers. And we also have some hardware extensions and stuff like that, robotics and so on and so forth. So just very briefly, two abstractions, two major abstractions have been added to Snap. One is what we call remote procedure calls, or RPCs. Basically, it's like a function call that happens to run on the server. And that enables us to provide all kinds of interesting services and wrap various existing web APIs like Google Maps, weather information, movie database, and lots of others. Okay. And we also have some utilities that run on the server, for example, cloud variables or GNU plot to generate plots and so on and so forth. And these are just a few examples of what RPCs enable. On the left, you see our earthquake application. So you have an interactive Google Map background and you can display earthquakes on top of that map. In the middle, we have an interesting project where you just type in the title of any movie and then it pops up the pictures of the three leading cast members. Or unfortunately, very timely is our COVID service. So in this case, we are plotting the COVID data, again, anywhere on Earth using the Johns Hopkins database. The other major abstraction is message passing. Basically, it's very similar to events, but not being confined to the single project, you can actually send messages anywhere on the internet to any other NetsBlox project running anywhere. And you can carry data. So these are the two main differences. Some things that you can do with message passing, all kinds of games, including what I call the semi-pong game, where two computers run only half of the court and the ball passes from one computer to another. And there are a bunch of other games that you can do. Or here on this side, this is our shared whiteboard application. This is the entire code that you can see on the screen, and it enables two students sharing the stage. So they are drawing on each other's stage. So the blue one is one student, the red pen corresponds to another student. All right. So that was the very brief introduction to NetsBlox for those of you who are not familiar with it. And so what about climate change? Okay, so of course, climate change is a really important and timely topic, and it's especially interesting or important for young people. So we decided to pick this area where we try to kind of teach both programming and an important real world problem like climate change kind of in a synergistic manner. Yeah. So it also illustrates how computing is relevant in real life and hopefully increases awareness of climate change. So what does this mean that we kind of started this climate change project? But what we wanted to do is to implement a set of services that provide access to climate change related data and a set of example projects that teachers can take on and teach in their classroom so students can work on these projects. Okay. So most of my talk is actually going to be a demonstration. So let me bring up Chrome. Let's make it big. So this is the NetsBlox homepage that you can see here. Okay. We have all kinds of resources and tutorials and things like that. And on the main page, of course, you see a bunch of example projects, both that we are created or some of these are student created projects. So feel free to visit. This is netsblox.org, netsblox.org. So if you click the try now button, of course, it will take you to the editor, which should look pretty familiar to everybody because it's basically Snap. Okay? The only difference is this new category that we call network. Okay? Let's see. Is it big enough or should I zoom the block size a little bit? Depends on how big screen you are looking at it. Let me increase the size a little bit. All right, so there are a number of blocks, not too many. For this presentation, the only block that is actually interesting is this call block. That's the block that enables you to call these remote procedure calls or RPCs. These RPCs are grouped to services. So the first pull-down menu lists a number of services. You can see we have Google Maps and a bunch of others. And of course, we have a submenu for climate-related services. So let's just pick one. This is the data that's available from NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. They have an observatory in Hawaii that they have been measuring the CO2 concentrations since 1958. So that's the service we are going to use. And if we pull down the second menu, it shows the RPCs associated with that particular service. Well, in this case, we have only two RPCs. One of them is called Get CO2 Trend. So as you noticed, once I picked this RPC, it reconfigured the block to show me what input arguments that particular RPC is requesting. But in fact, these are optional arguments. I can just execute this call. And this is the data that was returned from the NetsBlox server. So it's an n/2 matrix. Basically, the two columns correspond to years, but actually months in a convenient single number, and the CO2 concentrations in ppm. So back in March 1958, it was about 314. And if we zoom, I guess the last one is sometime in 2019, was up to 400 there. So it tells me that we should update this data source on our server because we have more than a years of extra data that we are missing. So we'll do that. But anyway, so what can you do with this data? Okay, it's a table of a bunch of numbers. Well, I mentioned that we have a charting service. So if you select the chart, it also has two RPCs and one of them is this draw RPC. The first input argument is the lines, in other words, the data sources. And the second one is options that allow me to customize the chart, but that's optional. So I can just drag this block right in here, okay, and see what happens. Well, it generated an image. Okay. Well, what we can do with that image is change the costume. So let's see what happens. All right. So there we have the CO2, the actual measured CO2 concentrations from 1958 to last year. Okay. So the trend is fairly obvious. Now, what's the difference between the CO2 trend and the get raw CO2? The difference is this. So there is an annual cycle, especially pronounced on the northern hemisphere, related to vegetation, winter, summer. So that's why we have this ripple in the data. Okay, but the trend is basically just a moving average for a year. Now, what if I wanted to print both of these things? Well, that's pretty easy. I can provide two data sources and put them in a list. So now I can do the trend and the raw data and chart them both. Okay, still not easily visible. Let's just pick a 5-year period. Let's see. Now you can see that the green one is the actual monthly measured parts per million CO2 concentration in Hawaii, and the purple one is a moving average of that data. So as you can see, first of all, it's pretty interesting that we have this data available. Second, I mean, basically used one block, or if you count all the embedded boxes, like 5 blocks of code, and we have a working application that illustrates climate change to students. You don't need to have a loop, you don't need to have an if statement, you don't even need to have a variable. So you can actually start teaching this even in middle school as part of an introductory programming course. All right, what other data do we have? Well, we have different services. Let's look at the historical temperature service. Now this has 5 RPCs. They basically return the same data. It's the monthly temperature estimates provided by the Berkeley Earth Institute. They went back to 1750 or so, and based on a bunch of different factors, they computed their estimates of temperature. And then the other RPCs basically return process data, basically a moving average for a year, 5 years, 10 years, or 20 years. So let's pick the 20-year anomaly, and then it expects a region. Now, one region we can provide is called global. So let's do this. So you can see, actually, in this case, we went back to 1860. And that's kind of the data we have all the way to 2010 or so. Now, what's on the y-axis? Well, that's Celsius, okay? But why is it zero? So it's called temperature anomaly for a reason. So you can see between 1950 and 1980, the temperature was fairly stable. So they took the average of those years, and that's the baseline, that's zero. And everything else is relative to that. Okay, so it basically this measure is used to kind of identify trends in the data. So it doesn't matter whether you are getting this data for Greenland or I don't know, Congo. This should be kind of the same figure because it's a relative temperature to the kind of the normal expected temperature in that region. All right. Well, you can, of course, look at other areas. You can look at Europe, for example. And there, I mean, the trends are kind of similar, but not exactly. All right. So let me actually switch to an application that's a project that's already done. Again, it's a bit smaller. So hang on, let me increase the block size. Yes, and we have the dreaded white screen of death Chrome bug pop up, but I was kind of anticipating this. So I have Firefox open too, except looks like Firefox died on me. The yellow screen of death. Let's see, why is that? So that's still there. Global temperature anomaly. Why would this? Well, try to refresh it and see what happens. I'm hopeful. All right. So basically what you see here now, the green point cloud is the monthly data and the purple line is the 10-year mean. And you can see that we have now titles and labels and other things. Still, the code itself is just a few blocks, okay? So basically, we just plot these two different data sources, and there is this custom block called chart options. That basically sets up the options data structure, which is a list of key value pairs. So it's, again, an n by two kind of matrix, if you want to see this executed, then this is what you will get. You can have the title, size, labels, all kinds of other things, and it's pretty easy to set up, okay? So again, if you want to create more sophisticated charts, it's still pretty easy and perfectly doable in high school courses.
Akos, you have a request for showing Antarctic data.
We shall do that in a second. Yeah. All right. Well, here is I-score data. Let's see how am I doing on time. Not particularly well, so I'll skip a few things. So this is actually I-score data. We have a service called I-score, and we have 5 or 6 I-score data sources from Antarctica and Greenland. This one, I believe, uses the Antarctic composite I-score, which is basically merged data from several I-scores from Antarctica. And so in this case, we are displaying the estimated CO2 concentrations from that I-score. That's the purple line. And then conveniently, the Hawaii actual observations for the last 50 years or so. And you can, it's hard to mistake the trend. Now, instead of going back only 4,000 years, we can actually go back 800,000 years. That's the oldest data that we have. And there you have it. So going back 800,000 years, we never exceeded 300 ppm. Well, that's not true anymore. We are way over that. And again, you can see that the actual project itself is pretty simple. A different way of plotting the same kind of data, it gets a little bit more complicated, but now it's not time, but it's CO2 versus estimated temperature anomaly. So the green point cloud displays this data going back 800,000 years. You can see a clear correlation between ppm CO2 and the temperature. And then of course the purple data is for the last 100 years or so. Actually, I'm not using the Mauna Loa data here, but one of the other I scores. So this stops at 300, what is it, 70 or so even. So right now we are somewhere here, we are 415 and about 1 Celsius over the baseline, as I mentioned before. So, well, this clearly illustrates that something is up and it's probably not good. All right. So these are the kind of projects that uses plotting. So after a while, probably students will be kind of sick of plots. It becomes a bit boring. So here is another project that uses hurricane data. Now, of course, this gets a little bit more complicated. First of all, we have the interactive Google Maps. So I can, well, actually, let me start this so that everything is there. So you can zoom and pan the map with the arrow keys, and then I can enter a year. So let's say, let's pick 2005, These are the named hurricanes in 2005. Let's pick Katrina. Okay, and now it's gonna animate the track of Katrina. While I do that, I can zoom in and it will restart the plot. Okay, when it's blue, that's a tropical storm category, and once it reaches 75 miles per hour sustained wind speed, then it becomes a hurricane, and that's indicated by the red track. And you can see it showing the actual track. Now, this one only uses the track and the intensity, but the data service provides wind speeds and other relevant information to hurricanes. Okay. So that's probably, after plotting a bunch of data, that's probably more interesting for students. Finally, let me show another one. So in case you missed yesterday, there was a presentation about NetsBlox titled Make Your Own Data Service in NetsBlox. So we of course provide a bunch of these data services on our server, but if you are a teacher and you want to have some local data or some other data source that we didn't think of, well, what can you do? Well, you can actually create your own data service from within NetsBlox. And I did that for a few cases. Oops. All right. Well, let me try to go back to Firefox. So hopefully this bug will be gone with the new morphic stuff. Now it's not even showing Firefox. What happened to Firefox? Well, I'm not having much luck today. Oh. All right, so the data source I wanted to show is under this community tab. So you can see that a few users created their own services, and it's really easy to do. All you need is a CSV file, and then you can just load it and call the service creation RPC. And then immediately once you do that, you will show up here. So under my username, you can see I have a bunch of additional climate change related data sources. For example, I picked the Fairbanks weather station that goes back to 100 years. So I have all kinds of values. So for example, this one goes back quite a bit, 100 years, and shows the daily maximum temperatures for, again, 100 years. So 36,000 data points. And this can be used for plotting trends, but hopefully this will open for me. No, it won't. All right, so let me go back to my presentation then quickly. So let me summarize what I just showed you. So these are the four most important services that are related to climate change. There are six projects that I showed. This was the last one. Basically, it creates a histogram of days, or the number of days that exceed a certain maximum temperature or that under a certain minimum temperature. And that kind of indicates kind of, for example, you can see that the last decade, there were a single day when the minimum temperature was minus 50 or below in Fairbanks, where in other decades there were quite a few more. So that's kind of another thing. Now we have another set of interesting projects that were kind of too complicated for this short presentation, but they can be found here. So let me actually put my presentation in the chat so that you can download it and explore additional services and projects that we have. That's not what I wanted. Where is it? Here it is. Chat. So So you should be able to download this presentation if you click on that link. Now, sorry about, we still have 5 minutes for questions. So please feel free to ask any questions. Just unmute yourself and go for it. In the meantime, there was one other project that I wanted to show you. Let's see whether it opens.
Akos, while you're loading it up, maybe a little context. So Akos has mentioned that these projects were made by students. They were made by students with the anticipation of having them work with, having them support middle school activities. And so some of the things that Akko showed dealt with some of the problems, challenges in data interpretation that we anticipate, that the students anticipated that middle school students would have. For example, when you have lots of fluctuation, how do you make an argument about trends? And so looking either zooming in time or looking at things like breaking records in that last project, as one way to understand that, in fact, yes, even though it's cold today, it's getting warmer over time.
So in the meantime, I'm showing this this little game. This doesn't have anything to do with NetsBlox. This could be a Snap project. It's a matching game where you have to match cards by flipping them over. So let me try to actually find a pair quickly. Was it that? Yes. So once you successfully find a pair, this will actually present information about one particular data source that paleoclimatologists use to uncover data from going back to millions of years. So that's kind of a fun activity. All right. Any questions?
And I guess Akash, I don't know if you said this, that this student was really interested in the different proxies for climate data that paleoclimatologists had used and wanted to help students to help middle school students to make sense of. Well, here they're measuring tree rings, there they're looking at coral, here they're looking at cave sediment. How do we put these things together? So that was her introduction.
Yes, in the meantime, there is a question in the chat. How much work is involved in creating a new data source, the raw data that the service would use? I mean, the raw data itself is available from a bunch of sources, right? So most of the data you saw here were from NOAA, which provides lots and lots of very interesting data. So that's basically publicly available and free to use. Berkeley Earth Institute has also interesting data sources, and there are a number of others. Some is proprietary in the sense that, for example, the Open Movie DB. Well, actually, that's not proprietary. It's a user-created data source, but nevertheless, they have some threshold. So when we try to use that API, we have to limit the number of requests, or they limit the number of requests, and so on and so forth. But actually, creating the raw data is usually easy. And now with this create your own data service, actually turning that into an actual data service is also very, very easy and quick. All right, so I think that's all the time we had. So thank you very much and enjoy the rest of the conference.